we are deriving the differential energy balance equation. We have derived the differential energy balance equation in terms of total energy. We started with the integral energy balance equation and obtained the differential energy balance equation in terms of total energy. We also looked at how to express the rate of heat in term, rate of work done term in the energy balance equation. So, we completed this bullet. So, we proceed now to express the differential energy balance equation in other forms, and what is objective? Finally, we have to express in terms of temperature. So, we will be sequentially deriving the energy balance equation in terms of these variables. Now, to proceed further to help us to express the energy balance in terms of these variables, it will be convenient for us if we express the differential total energy balance which are derived from a material particle viewpoint, and that is what we will do now, so that all the further derivations will become easier for us. So, let us write down the differential total energy balance equation which are derived in the previous lecture. We have the transient term, the convection term, and then we have the rate of heat input term, and then rate of work done by the pressure forces. This is not new to us. We have already done a similar exercise when we derived the continuity equation and the linear momentum balance equation from a material particle viewpoint. So, let us quickly do that. It requires re-expression of the left hand side of the above equation. We expand all the derivatives using product rule. So, the first two terms are here, which is expansion of dou by dou t of rho e. Then, when we take this convection terms, we have already discussed that we should take rho v x together, and so the product rule is applied for this term and we get these two terms. Similarly, in the y direction, similarly in the z direction. Now, let us group the terms together, all the blue color terms and then all the red color terms. Now, if you look at the terms in red within the square bracket, we can easily identify that it is the equation of continuity, and hence it goes to 0. So, the second term drops off, and now if you look at the first term, we can easily identify that it is the substantial derivative of total energy. So, let us express that, the temporal term and the convection term. So, left hand side becomes rho d E by d t, where d by d t is the substantial derivative. So, the left hand side of this equation will express in terms of rho d E by d t. Of course, right hand side there is no change. How do you view this equation? This tells you the rate of change of total energy if you follow a fluid particle, and that is the term on the left hand side, of course, multiply by density, and right hand side we have net rate of heat input and net rate of work done. So, this expression was derived from a control volume point of view or Eulerian point of view. We have expressed the same equation from a Lagrangian point of view. We have expressed this for two reasons. One reason is that the further derivations will be easy if we express the energy balance equation from a material particle viewpoint. Other use is that the usual, the form in which the conservation equations are used are usually in the material particle viewpoint, and anyway we have done this for the differential mass balance and the momentum balance. So, analogously we have done for the differential total energy balance as well. So, let us proceed further So, next step is to derive the differential energy balance equation in terms of internal and kinetic energy. What is the starting point? The starting point of the equation which I have seen in the previous slide, expressing the differential energy balance in terms of total energy. This is the equation which I have seen, and as I said, we have written from a material particle viewpoint. Let us expand E. What does E tell us? E tells us the total energy per unit mass, which is sum of the internal energy per unit mass, the kinetic energy per unit mass and the potential energy per unit mass. So, what we have done is just substituted for E in terms of the individual energy components. Reason is we want to separate out the gravitational part from this, or the potential energy part from this. Okay. Now, to proceed further, we will have to discuss the coordinate axis. We will choose this coordinate axis where y is along the horizontal direction, z is along the vertical direction. So, we choose a coordinate axis in which z is along the vertical direction. So, now g acts towards the negative z axis, and so we express the g vector as minus g k. And how do you express k? K can be expressed as gradient of z, and that is what is shown here. If you evaluate gradient of z, we have dou z by dou x which is 0, dou z by dou y 0, and we are left with the last term dou z by dou z which is unity. So, we have gradient of z as k vector. So, in this expression, we replace the k vector in terms of gradient of z. So, g vector becomes minus g into gradient of z. Now, g can be brought inside the gradient sign, and so we have got g vector as minus gradient of g z. What we have done is not new to us. We have already done this when we discussed the Bernoulli equation expressing g vector in terms of minus gradient of g z. Now, we will introduce a nomenclature for g z. We will express g z as phi. Remember, g z is a scalar. So, this expression tells you that the g vector is equal to minus gradient of phi, where phi is g z, and we can easily identify that it is the potential energy per unit mass. Now, let us discuss what this equation tells us. Now, if you look at this equation, left hand side we have gravitational force and right hand side we have the gravitational potential energy. Of course, both are per unit mass. So, this equation relates two viewpoints of G. What is one viewpoint? We view it as force per unit mass on the left hand side. On the right hand side, we view it as a potential energy per unit mass. And how are they related? The gravitational force is related to the minus of the gradient of the gravitational potential. Okay. So, the main objective of this equation is to relate the two viewpoints of G. With one viewpoint is we view G as a gravitational force per unit mass. We can also view G as a gravitational potential energy per unit mass, and we are relating these two by this expression. So, now what we will do is we said we want to separate the effect of d by dt of g z in the left hand side. So, let us evaluate that rho into the substantial derivative of g z or the substantial derivative of the gravitational potential. Now, what is d by dt? Let us expand it. We have that unsteady term or the local term, which is dou by dou t of g z, and then we have the convection term which is v dot gradient of g z. Now, the gravitational potential is not a function of time. So, the first term is 0, leaving us with only the second term rho and then v dot gradient of g z. Now, from this equation, we will substitute gradient of g z as minus g vector, and that is what is done here. And then if you write that, we get minus rho into g dot v. So, what is that we have done? Taken the substantial derivative of the gravitational potential on the left hand side in this equation, of course multiplied by rho, and express that as minus rho g dot v. Now, what do? We retain only the substantial derivative of internal energy and kinetic energy on the left hand side, take the substantial derivative of gravitational potential to the right side, and so what you get? You have the same term here on the right hand side, you have this term also on the right hand side, and when this term goes to the right hand side, it becomes plus rho g dot v, and that is written here in terms of the components of the gravitational vector and the velocity vector. Okay. So, what we have done is started with the differential energy balance equation expressed in terms of total energy, and then in the left hand side we have the derivative, substantial derivative of the gravitational potential that we expressed in terms of minus rho g dot v, brought it to the right hand side, and it becomes plus rho g dot v. And now left hand side is left only with the substantial derivative of internal energy and the kinetic energy. Okay. So, now let us understand what is the meaning of this term. Okay. And that is what we are going to discuss now. Rho g dot v is the term on the right hand side and expressed in terms of the components here. Now, we know that rate of work done is given by the dot product of force into the velocity vector. So, if you compare this expression and this expression, it is clear that this represents rate of work done, but because g is force per unit mass, g dot v represents rate of work done per unit mass, and because you are multiplying by density, we eventually get rate of work done by gravitational force per unit volume, and it is on the fluid. So, the term rho g dot v on the right hand side represents rate of work done. Why is it? Because it is a dot product between a force vector and a velocity vector, but force is per unit mass, multiply by density. So, it becomes rate of work done per unit volume, and the work done by the gravitational force on the fluid. So, let us see how do we justify that this is on the fluid and by gravitational force. Okay, let us take a small example. Let us say you have a pipe and then water flows up through the pipe, that is what is shown here. Okay. Now, when the water is flowing up through the pipe, let us evaluate this term, the rate of work done by gravitational force rho g dot v. Of course, we know that the g vector is minus g k vector, and because the fluid is flowing up, the velocity is v z into k vector. So, if you take the dot product, we get minus rho g v, where v is the magnitude of the velocity, which means it is negative, and which shows that work is done by the fluid against gravity, which is what we expect. When a fluid is flowing up through a pipe, work is done by the fluid against gravity, and that is why we said this term represents rate of work done on the fluid by gravitational force, of course per unit volume. So, that is the significance of the term rho g dot v. Now, also like to discuss one more aspect regarding the gravity term. If you look at this, what we have done is, of course, this is the energy balance in terms of the total energy, and this we have seen in the previous slide relating the substantial derivative of the gravitational potential to minus g dot v. and then we substituted here, okay, and then expressed in this form. What is that we have done? If you look at this equation where we had substantial derivative of gravitational potential, it played the role of flow of potential energy. So, when it was on the left hand side, it represented rate of flow of potential energy when it was on the left hand side. Now, when it came on the right hand side, what does it represent? It represents rate of work done by gravitational force. So, now two ways of including the effect of gravity in an energy balance equation. When it is on the left hand side, it is rate of flow of potential energy. Why is it? We know that this represents convection term. We have seen convection for velocity, convection for temperature. Similarly, here we have convection of potential energy. So, that is why when it is on the left hand side, it represents rate of flow of potential energy. When we take it to the right side, it becomes rate of work done by gravitational force. Okay. So, two different viewpoints, two different ways of including the effect of gravity in the energy balance equation. We started with including as a rate of potential energy. The reason is we started from the first law of thermodynamics, the law of physics, where left hand side we had all the energy, which includes internal, kinetic and potential energy. Because we started from that, and from that we got the integral energy balance, from that we got the differential energy balance, the left hand side for us contained to begin with the effect of gravity as a rate of potential energy. But now, we are proceeding towards deriving an equation for temperature. So, eventually finally only internal energy should be left out. So, at this stage we are taking out the effect of the potential energy, we are not removing it from the energy balance, we are taking the effect from the left hand side and taking it to the right hand side, and the significance becomes rate of work done by gravitational force. Okay. That is what we have done here conceptually. So, that on the left hand side we are left out only with the internal energy and the kinetic energy. That is the whole objective of this exercise. And remember, when we discussed the differential energy balance in this form for the total energy, we said this represents rate of heat input term and this represents rate of work done by pressure, and we said we are neglecting rate of work done by the viscous stresses. We also said that there is no term corresponding to the rate of work done by the gravitational force or the body force, and we also said that that is hidden somewhere in the left hand side, and now that is what we are discussed now. Whatever is hidden on the left hand side, hidden I would say not as work done, but as potential energy or flow of potential energy. Now, we have separated that out and brought to the right hand side. So, now if you look at the energy balance equation, this is the rate of heat input, and now we have one term corresponding to rate of work done by pressure force, and we have another term corresponding to the rate of work done by the body force or the gravitational force. Of course, there is no rate of work done term corresponding to the viscous stresses to our level of discussion. A full complete derivation will include that term as well.